want to also welcome those who are joining us on the recorded media, LifeGate Outreach TV, and the audio media. We pray that the Lord will perfect all that concerns you also, in the name of Jesus. I am glad to be back in church. I was not privileged to be here last Sunday because I had cause to have ministry outside the country for that weekend. And my flights could not have been arranged to be here for the service. That's why I missed the service last Sunday. But I want to trust God that everything that happened in the course of the sessions last Sunday blessed you as much as it blessed me as I reviewed the messages and the aspects of the service on the day. And I pray that the Lord will continue to cause these blessings to abide and abound in your lives. In the name of Jesus. We want to really appreciate God for great giftings in the house. I thank God for the ministers that minister in songs. I thank God for the ministers that ministered in the word on the course of the day. In the course of the day last Sunday, particularly the persons of Pastor Cephas and Pastor Lola. Let's appreciate God for them. Hallelujah. And all the ministers in the house that ministered in one way or the other. I want you to know that the work of the ministry is a work of soldiers. That is why the Bible says no one engaged in military affairs will entangle himself with civilian affairs or the affairs of this world. And so I want to be thankful to God that we are a military people for Jesus Christ. And the Lord will continue to strengthen everyone, even as we seek his face further, in the name of Jesus. So you are welcome to today's service. And this Sunday particularly, we will be ending our series on kingdom character development. Kingdom character development. We had a long list of about 8 sessions of kingdom character. Developing kingdom character by vision, developing kingdom character by love, developing kingdom, the kingdom character of love, developing the kingdom character of our abilities, the kingdom character of faith, the kingdom character of excellence, the kingdom character of trust. And last week we looked at the kingdom character of perseverance. And we say all these are traits and characteristics that must define a Christian in this day and age. And today, by the grace of God, we are ending it with the kingdom character of generosity. Somebody say generosity. We read from Proverbs chapter 11 and we saw how good and how it is expected that a person be generous. And we read extensively all the verses there, and we will be touching on some of them later on. But I just want to say that there is so much that we can learn from the scriptures. The banner we have today, thank you very much, is the a banner of a picture I found captured exactly what God laid on my heart concerning generosity. It is about the heart connected to the hand. What you have in your heart, the good you have in your heart to do, always being extended by your hand. Generosity is a function of the two coming together. The hand that gives without a heart is not generous. The heart that is full of good intentions but does not release with the hand is still not generous. So I like the picture that shows that person holding a shape of a heart in their hand, typifying the fact that generosity has to do with our hearts connected to our hands and doing the things that God expects of us to do. I define generosity as a kingdom character that facilitates the physical expression of the good thoughts and the good intentions that are in our hearts. Generosity is the vehicle through which we express the good that we desire to really do. And when we live like that, what happens is that every time there is good in our hearts, if we allow the character of generosity to be formed in us, God enables us to do the things that he is putting as good in our hearts to do. And the purpose of this message today is to help us to see how we can do that, why we should do that, how we can do that, and the rewards of doing so. And as I was meditating on these things, I found that Every one of our core values and perseverance, which we looked at last week, which is not necessarily one of the emphases of our core values, but one of the kingdom characters that we also mentioned. Every one of our core values, the five of them, and perseverance, have a way that they link with generosity. Hallelujah. Generosity, when you look at our core value of love, when we look at generosity in those terms, we see that generosity really is about expressing our love. Somebody say expressing our love for God and fellow humans. Say expressing our love for God and fellow humans with every God-given ability. Say it like you mean it. With every God-given ability. By faith. And excellent. And excellence. With trust in God. As my supplier. That is what generosity is. Expressing my love for God and for fellow humans. With every God-given ability that God has put in me. By faith. And in excellence, meaning doing it to the best of my ability per time, and with trust in God continually being my supplier. Every time you express good to others, every time good in whatever shape comes from you to another person, what you are doing is that you are releasing a bit of God that is deposited on your inside, that is put in your life, and you are making it available. So God enables you to love him back because he first loved you. And the love that you embraced in him allows you to love him back. And it is that same love that is shed abroad in your heart so that you can love your neighbor as yourself. And when you love God and love people, you cannot do it in the physical. You cannot do it just in your sense knowledge. You have to do it using the God-given abilities by faith. You have to believe that God exists and he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him truly. So I find that as we do these things by faith, by excellence, we continue to trust in God. And we also continue to persevere. We continue to make every effort not to grow weary in well-doing. The Bible says, do not grow weary in well-doing, because you will soon reap if you faint not. The reason why Paul gave that admonition to the Galatians is simply because it is very, very possible. That is Galatians 6:9. It is very, very possible for you to grow tired in well-doing. Particularly when you look at the reactions you get at times for doing good. Every time you feel tired in doing something good, you must come back to the fact that the reward comes on the altar of perseverance. Not giving up. Many people have given up their faith because they did everything they thought was right to do as Christians. They served, they gave their money, they did everything, but they were betrayed by leaders of churches. They were betrayed by fellow brothers and fellow sisters. And so some of those people today gave up their faith and they don't realize that they are cutting themselves short from the reward that is for those who persevere in doing well. You and I must understand that generosity has nothing to do with the way we are treated, but it has everything to do with the way we are commanded by God. May God continue to help us all to be generous. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Generosity is a principle of eternal life. I believe that it connects our earthly actions to heavenly reactions. Every time you take steps in taking some earthly actions of generosity here, you trigger things in the heavens that you could not have reached. So many of us want the things from the heavens. The Bible says we should set our minds on things above and not on things on the earth. And we wonder, how can I touch the things in the heavens? It's very simple. Use your substance. Use your time. Use your heart. Use your ability to touch the things here on earth that touches God in heaven. And God will move things in the heaven on your behalf. I say God will move things in the heaven on your behalf. In the name of Jesus. Matthew chapter 6 from verse 19. The Bible says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on the earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. Now, how does that add up to what we are saying? He said, do not lay up for yourselves treasures. The key verse there is laying it up for yourself. The key phrase there that makes it wrong is laying it up for yourself. Whatever treasure, whatever thing you have here on earth is to be deployed. The Bible says if you lay it up for yourself, what you are doing is you are detaching the protection of heaven. In Proverbs chapter 16, verse 5, the Bible says, oh God, you are the one that will preserve me, verse 1. And in verse 5, it says, you are the one that maintains my lot. When you lay up treasures for yourselves, you are giving room for moth and rust to destroy. When you have disregard for the finances that God gives to your hand, you have disregard for using it to the glory of God and using it to be a blessing to other people, you are giving it exposure to moth and rust. Your finances will not be destroyed. Amen. I say your lot will not be destroyed. Amen. The Bible says thieves, they break in and they steal. Malachi chapter 3 tells us that he is called the devourer. So if you don't want the devourer in your finances, you need to understand how to know how to be generous to God and how to be generous to God's people. Every time you do a thing in the way of the commandment, by ways of tithes and offerings and giving to those that you need to give to be a blessing, you prevent the moth and the rust that destroys the treasures of everyone else on the face of the earth. Verse 20. The Bible says, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. When you lay it up in heaven by doing the earthly things that are of generosity, the earthly things that are commanded, the Bible says, in that place, moth nor rust cannot destroy. Thieves cannot break in. Verse 21 says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Every time you do the things that God commands you to do on earth, you connect not only to the blessings that come from heaven, but you connect to the lifestyle of heaven. You connect to the joy of heaven. You connect to the joy of heaven. Amen. You connect to the peace of heaven. Amen. You connect to the serenity of heaven. Amen. The Bible says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. That is why you don't live a normal life like everybody else that is connected only to the earthly. Your testimony is different. I say your testimony is different. Yes. And your testimony will continue to be different. Yes. In the name of Jesus. Yes. Learn these principles. In 1 Timothy chapter 6. Paul said to Timothy, verse 17. He said, command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty. The word haughty there means high-minded. Not to be full of pride. He said not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in what? The living God, who does what? Who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Hallelujah. The reason God gave you the word enjoy there doesn't mean to be selfish about it. It simply means you are able to use it for yourself to do the things that you need to do. Let's say God gives you some money. You are able to use it to do the things that you need to do, and yet God has given you so much of it in the sense that you are able to also be a blessing to others. And I'll explain what I mean by being rich and having so much of it. When many people read scriptures like this, in my few years of being in church life, I know that a lot of Christians detach themselves from this because they say that it's talking about very, very rich and very wealthy people. On the face of it, it looks like that. But the reality is that riches, as far as this kingdom is concerned, is everything God has put in your hand. Everybody is rich. Everybody is rich. Every child of God. Now look at the last phrase. The Bible says, he gives us. Did he say he gives some people? Say he gives me too. Richly. All things. To enjoy. Poverty is a mindset. You heard it from one of our great mentors here. He said 2 years ago, I think it was Reverend Kola, when he came here, He talked about poverty. He said that is why you see a person in some of these developing countries where there is corruption in the blatant daylight. I mean, there's corruption everywhere. But there are some countries where corruption is just a monster. Where people will steal $1 billion and steal it again next month and steal it again the third month. It is mad. That is why such a person is not rich. He is poor. Very poor. In the mind, he's sick. $1 billion can feed many nations, and one person will be stealing it at the rate of once per month for 4 years. It is absurd. But when we understand that God gives us richly all things, we don't live like such people. We understand whatever God gives to us is being given to us richly to enjoy. It's a mindset. You need to find a way to understand how God makes you a rich person. Otherwise, you will never be generous. So what does that mean? If 50 pounds is what you have, look for an occasion to be able to give 5 to bless somebody. Of course, pay your tithes and give somebody, even if it's 1 pound, buy an ice cream for a child. Live like a rich man. Stop being stingy. Don't wait until you think you have all the money in the world. When you are coming to church, put some money. Don't come to church. You come to church, you count the exact offering you want to give. And you wrap it up in 2 envelopes, sealed up. And then when they say it's offering, you give that one. And then nothing else is left in your pocket. No, live life from today. Even if it's 1 pound, put it in your pocket to want to be a blessing to somebody. That is how you start. Then that 1 pound turns to 10 pounds. Then it turns to 100. Because you are living a life of generosity from the stage that you are in. The Bible says, command those who are rich in this present age not to be high-minded. This means that every one of us has been given riches, and we must not live life in the stinginess that the enemy will want us to live it. Generosity is an expression of love. It started with God in John chapter 3, verse 16. John chapter 3, verse 16. He said, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish. Somebody say, he gave.
He gave.
Because he loved.
He
gave because he loved. Now look at your neighbor. Say, you too must give
if you love.
Hallelujah. You must understand that even if you have anything that is looking like situations of challenges of life in your life, generosity is a mindset that you must develop, knowing that it is an expression of your love for God. 1 John 3, 16 says, by this we know love, because he laid down his life for us, and we also ought to lay down, 1 John 3, 16, and we also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Amen. How do we lay down our lives for the brethren? To die for them again? No. Jesus has died once. You don't need to die for anybody. Hallelujah. I believe my work as a pastor, by the grace of God, is to love the people of God, to feed them the word of God, to look after their welfare, and to believe God. But God did not call me to die for another human being. So if your situation is trying to kill me, I will leave you alone and pass you to your Savior. Because he's the one who died for all of us. You are laughing. That is true. You say, which kind of pastor is this one? It's true. He did not call me to die for another person. No, 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 no. When your situation wants to kill me, I say, Lord, this is one of your children that you died for. Help us all together so that we don't die together. He wants to kill me. He did not call us to die for. He said we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Before you misunderstood, he now explained in the next verse how to lay down your lives for the brethren. Let's go to verse 17. Verse 17, let's read it together. This is how you lay down your lives for your brethren. Let's read it together. But whoever has this world's goods and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart from him, how does the love of God abide in him? This is what it means. You have this world's goods, whatever it is. Everything that you have is good. It has come from God. Don't measure it in terms of the quantity or even the quality of it per se. It is your heart in wanting to bless a brother that needs it. If you have three items of shirt, clothing, and you are a man, and you find that you are in the church or in a place where you find another man always wearing one, nothing stops you from giving one of those that you have to the person. And I challenge you, you give them not the one that you are tired of using. Not the one that you are tired of using, and that one too is even tired of seeing you. Anytime you open your wardrobe by itself, it starts sliding to the other side of the room. Because it's tired of seeing you. No, not that one. You take the one that is good and befitting for the brother, and you give them. Why? Because the Bible says you have this world's goods. Many people think that this means that you have all the money in the world to do the things that you want to do anyhow. No, you don't wait for that to happen. You don't. You start from where you are and you start giving out. Whatever God does in your life is for you to be able to go to the next level. And you must understand that there is nothing in this world that can stop you from manifesting the world's good. You have something. Tell your neighbor for me, you have something. Say, every time you see a need, you will not shut your heart. The grace of God will be sufficient for you. Verse 18 says, my little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Do you know that many times, many of us love in word because we're afraid? When people come to you and they are trying to tell you the problems or the challenge that they have, you know, at times people don't listen. You just immediately, when you see certain people, you just immediately assume that I cannot help this person. But I have found many, many times that a lot of times when people tell you a story of 30 minutes and you are waiting to hear what you think will be a bombshell of what they actually needed, at the end of it, in many cases, there is something you can do about it. You don't believe me? If you listen to the person from the heart of the Spirit, God will begin to give you ideas. You may not be able to do everything they want, but there are certain things that God will put in your heart that you'll be able to do for them. So you don't love them in word alone. James said, don't just look at them and say, brother, be filled. Brother, be healed. No, he said, you don't do that. If the matter has substance that you can address, you take of your substance and you bless them with it. Hallelujah. And at times, it may just be a word of advice, a word that will help them to move to the next level in their lives. Whatever it is, give a listening ear so that you don't just love in word or in tongue, but you are loving in deed and in truth. May the Lord continue to empower us in the name of Jesus. Selfishness is an enemy of generosity. Every trace of selfishness in our lives will continue to die by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Friends, I want you to know that selfishness, like pride, is one of those things you have to intentionally deal with, especially in our day and age. It has been prophesied. Remember Paul's prophecy to Timothy? He said, in the last days, perilous times will come. 1 Timothy 4. He said, people will be lovers of themselves. They will be boastful. They will be proud. They will be arrogant. They will have itching ears. But one of the big problems of the end time is that people will be selfish. People will be lovers of themselves. So you see them come into a plane. And I was telling my wife yesterday, it's so funny what happens these days. You see them come into a plane and once they put up their bag in the hold, they just closed it. There is still space for about two or three more bags. They close it and they sit down and belt up as if, pilot, we can go now, I'm in. Meanwhile, other people are still coming in. They need the same space. Have you seen such people before? It's selfishness of the highest order. And we must not let it creep into our lives. Don't just think me, myself, and I alone. Always think about other people. Luke chapter 12, Jesus gave a story of this man who thought he had everything going for him, but he was just selfish. From verse 16, He said, then he spoke a parable to them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man yielded plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Somebody say, I. He said, what shall I do? Since I. Somebody say, I. Everything about him was me, I. What shall I do? Since I have no room to store my crops. Verse 18. Let's read it together and keep noticing the I's. So he said, I will do this. I will put down my barns and build greater. And there I will store all my crops and my goods. Verse 19. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. Verse 20. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul will be required from you. We need to understand, when we have any increase whatsoever, what should be coming to our thoughts and our mind is, Lord, who do you want me to bless? What next do you want me to do in my local congregation? Some of you have been looking at this building. Some things have not changed here for some time. And God is laying on your heart that you can do something. I'm not asking for it now. I'm only telling you how it works. When those couple of thousands pass into your hand, some extra, some bonus, some business you did, and God shows you that you can be a blessing, don't waste time at all. Don't say, I will build my barns. I will pull down this. Think about the things that you can do to be a blessing to somebody. First, to God and to somebody else. And God will continue to enlarge your territory. I say, God will enlarge your territory. Yeah. One of my most favorite mentors who went to be with the Lord on the 1st of June of the year I was born in 1969, Mr. R.G. Letourneur. He lived from 1888 to that very year. And Letourneur was a Christian businessman. They called it, they nicknamed him God Businessman. Letourneur was a very, very interesting American man who, at 14, did not have anything. But God began to give him ideas about how to design big machines. And he started from the factory he was working and his garage. He started to put ideas together. And before you knew it, God blessed this man so much. He went to his pastor. He said, Pastor, I want to be a child of God. I want to be a minister of the gospel. Because in his days, people had to either be pastors or nothing. And his pastor thanked God for that great man, whoever he is. I don't know his name right now. But the story says, the man said to him, you can be God's businessman. You can be in ministry and be in business. And Letourneur said, wow, this is what I want to do. And so God began to give Letourneur all the wisdom, and he began to make these machines. And they began to call him the man that moved men and mountains. His machines were ferrying people in the time of the war and was used to build a lot of bridges and so many construction equipment that Letourneur made in his time. But one of the things that Letourneur said is not, he's saying that it is not how much of my money I give to God, but how much of his money I get to keep. It is not how much of my money I give to God, because there is no money that you and I have that is ours. It has come from God. God gave it to us. It is everything that we have is his. And the Letourneur said, it is not how much I give to God from his money, but how much I keep for myself from his money. When you realize in your life that everything in your hand has come from God, your mindset about being generous changes. Selfishness is destroyed. Selfishness only comes because you think you had right to it. Selfishness only comes because you think that it is your power that gave it to you. Look at that man. He said, my barns have bought, my field has yielded so much. He said, my barns has been filled. Now I will pull down. I will do that. No one regard for God. That's why God said to him, you're a fool. And Psalm 14 verse 1, as I always say to you, says, a fool says in his heart, there is no God. He said, you're a fool. This night your soul will be required from you. May God continue to help us to be generous. In the name of Jesus. Scripturally, there are acceptable standards of generosity. The first thing is that generosity must be sacrificial. We know from Romans 12:1, the Bible says that we must present our bodies as living sacrifices. But I want us to go straight to Luke chapter 21, verse 1. We need to be sacrificial. This is doing whatever we do at a cost. Whatever we do for God or God's people or needy people around us, we do it at a cost. We don't do it carelessly. We are sacrificial about it. The Bible says, and he looked up and saw the rich putting their gifts into the treasury. And he saw also a certain poor widow putting in 2 mites. So he said, truly, I say to you that this poor widow has put in more. Somebody say she put in more. She has put in more than all. For all these out of their abundance have put in offerings for God. But she out of her poverty put in all. Somebody say she put in all. So when we talk about generosity, we are talking about quality as opposed to quantity. And what I mean by that is that quality is relative. When your size is 100 pounds and you give the 100 pounds, what you are doing is that you are giving qualitatively something that has actually cost you something. When your size is 1,000 pounds and you are giving 300 pounds, it may look like you have brought in more than the person that gave the 100 pounds sacrificially. But in the eyes of God, that person has not given up to the person that gave 100 pounds. Because the 300 is not the quality of the man who should have given 1,000. Am I making sense? So we must understand our size per time. We must understand our size per time. A time must come, and when you don't start from where you are, you never get to where you ought to get. You have to start being sacrificial. People will say, Brother Dave, you know, I've heard this many times before now in church life. People will say, I really want to give to God, but I don't have enough. And I say to them, you don't understand it. Whatever you have now is enough. And the more you give that one, the more God gives you more capacity to do more. But people wait until they think they earn 4 or 5 figures in a month before they can start to do something that will be worthy. The Bible says Jesus was looking at their offerings. Every day, Jesus looks at offerings. If any pastor tells you he's the one that looks at offerings, he's not a serious pastor. Because his own offering too is being looked at by Jesus Christ. A real pastor's offering is also being looked at by Jesus. So Jesus is looking. Every time we put those envelopes in, Jesus is looking. I'm not trying to harass you now. I know when we talk about offering, your brethren, it's another matter. I'm not trying to harass your life. I'm only trying to let you know that you need to know how to be generous from your heart. Let your offering cost you something. The day I found that many times without thinking, children will come. They say, the pizza man is here. How much is it? 28 pounds, 30 pounds, pizza. Since that day, I saw that it does not make sense to be giving 5 pounds in church. It does not make sense. Because if you can afford pizza of 30 pounds at a go without even thinking, then why must you think that 5 pounds is something you give to God? You must. I'm not saying this as a standard. I'm only saying to you, if you can afford certain things without even thinking, just know that that is your minimum level of what your offering should be. That is how you should know where your start, your life is. Otherwise, for the next 10 years, you will be giving 10 pounds and you think you are doing God a favor. You must decide to come out of it. You must decide and say, Lord, this is what I want to do. Has anybody ever imagined that one day you will do something of significance for God? If you don't imagine it and start from where you are, you can never do it. Have you ever imagined that one day you will be able to give to people who have no food to eat, no clothes to wear, brand new clothes, brand new items, and give them things that will help them for a long time? Have you ever imagined it? Or have you sat down to think that this is how your life will end? Generosity is a function of the heart. If it is strong in your heart, like a wise man said, God will put it in your hand. Every day you should look at where you are, believing God that God can take you to the next level. Be sacrificial. Tell your neighbor for me, be sacrificial. You can read Deuteronomy 15. We won't go to that because of time. The next thing is you should be joyful. Do it with delight.
2 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 6, he said, but this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, but he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Verse 7, let's read together. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Let your giving be done with joy. When you are packaging your offering, for example, package it and say, Lord, I thank you for this substance you have put in my hand. Such a privilege. Who am I to be giving you of what you have given me? I am so grateful. No matter what the size is, if you give an offering that way, you start to enjoy the benefits of heaven, that God will continue to put more resources into your hands. Hallelujah. The same thing when you are doing for somebody, do it cheerfully. Do it joyfully. Let them know that you are glad to give them this thing you are giving to them. Don't do it as if you are doing them a favor. Don't do it. That's very wrong. Somebody is in need of something, and then you are now giving it to them as if you are doing them a favor. Don't do that. You give it to them cheerfully, joyfully. Let them be glad to even be receiving it from you, because God loves a cheerful giver. And this does not, we use money a lot, but money is not the only thing we give. Money is a representation of so many things in our lives. That's why we use money as an illustration. Money represents your time, it represents your energy, it represents your ability. Most of the time, the money you give has come from work that you did and things that you have used your energy, you have used your time, you've used your resources. So at the end of the day, when you give money, it's like a sum total of all those things that you are giving out. So we use money a lot, but at times it's not just money. When you give time, qualitative time, to somebody, you are doing a cheerful work, and God wants you to do it cheerfully. When you respond to the things of God cheerfully, you let the heavens reward you cheerfully. Psalm 112. Psalm 112. We're going to the third one, which is graceful. Say, I will give sacrificially, joyfully, and gracefully. Gracefully means you are doing it unconditionally. Cheerfully means you are doing it, of course, with joy. Sacrificially means you are doing it because it cost you something. But gracefully means you are just doing it unconditionally. You are not expecting anything bad. Psalm 112 verse 5 says, a good man deals graciously and lends. He will guide his affairs with discretion. Again, it was Litanio that said, when the Lord has a job for you, he will give you the strength and the ability to do it. That is called grace. Every one of us must realize consistently that there is grace to do whatever we are doing, and grace for resources to be put in our hands. When such resources are put in our hands, what God is expecting you and I to do is to deal graciously. When the Bible uses lend, it usually means that you are giving to somebody that is in need. Hallelujah. It's not just that you are giving them a loan. Praise the Lord. And when you can avoid giving people loans, please avoid them, avoid giving it out. What do I mean by that? Somebody comes to you and they say, you know, brother, I just need to loan this £100. I really, really need it desperately. And you ask them, what is it for? My rent is just remaining £100, and somehow, because I've not been able to cover my shifts well or whatever reason, I need this £100 to make it up. Now, the truth is, they came for a loan. That is the reality. They came for a loan. But if God puts it in your heart to bless them genuinely, I don't say don't do that every time. Don't encourage any kind of laziness. That's not what I'm talking about. Yeah, because that's another thing altogether. But genuinely, sincerely, a brother or a sister needs this and you can afford it. You can even give them 200. Give them the 100 and don't expect them. Tell them not to bother to bring it back. Tell them to pay their rent. And whatever you can do to help them to get out of that situation so that they don't depend on people like that per se, you do for them. May God continue to help us. This is, tell your neighbor for me, this is practical Christianity. You see, when we come and we lift up our hands and say, Lord, you are beautiful, beautiful exchange, when only love can take. What you are doing there is you are saying, Lord, I want to live out totally for you. And you are singing those songs. What you are expected to do is to now live out the life that matches the things that we sing. Hallelujah. Before I close, I just want to quickly touch on some rewards of generosity. The first thing I noticed from the scripture is that there is supernatural supply. Every time you are generous, you will receive supernatural supply. Luke chapter 6 verse 38. Say, give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. I say, God, we keep supplying you supernaturally. In the name of Jesus. Supernatural supply simply means that God just adds to you from sources that are not the natural sources. The places that you would have expected that God will add to you are not it. God adds to you in ways that you cannot measure. God gives you divine health. God gives you divine favors. God helps you to attain things that naturally you would not have been able to do. Just because you are giving. As you give, I decree that it shall be given to you. In the name of Jesus. The second thing is supernatural increase. Say supernatural increase. This is a multiplication of what you already have. Like the 5 loaves and the 2 fish being able to feed the 5,000. Somehow, this is a principle that I have led for a majority of my life. I find that what looks like an income in the physical has never been what God uses to sustain me. He multiplies it supernaturally. He meets my needs supernaturally. And so I don't stop giving because I realize, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 11, verse 24, he said, there is one who scatters, yet he increases the more. And there is one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to what? Many people are in poverty or in lack today because they are withholding more than is necessary. You need to know how to give out. When you give out, you are rich with supernatural increase. I say, when you give out, you are rich with supernatural increase. This is how Litonior lived his life. And as he was making those money, God was blessing the business, more ideas. Go and search him out. Robert Gilmore Letourneur lived from 1888 to 1969. Great servant of God. He turned the 90-10% formula around. He gave God 90% and kept 10% to himself. When some human beings are still struggling to give the 10%. He gave God 90% and God blessed him so much that even the 10% was still an overflow. Till today, his foundation is still giving scholarships to children and to people. He has a university built that he built in his lifetime called the Litonior University. Their motto is that by faith we shall excel, but by ingenuity we shall be set apart. Until today, in Longview, Texas, that university remains one of the most viable technical universities in the world, designing heavy equipment and now, of course, very sophisticated tools because of the spirit of generosity that outworked itself in one man. May God continue to help us. Verse 25 says, the generous soul will be made rich. You will be made rich. And he said, he who waters will also be watered himself. My God will keep watering you. He will keep blessing you in the name of Jesus. The third thing is supernatural replenishment. I talked about multiplication. I talked about increase. But there's also supernatural replenishment. This is Proverbs 19 verse 17. He said, he who has pity on the poor lends to the Lord. And he, God, will pay back what he has given. Don't you like God telling you that he will pay you back? He said he will pay back. I say he will pay back. I have never seen where I gave out money and God did not replace that money. So before I know it, I'm giving it out again because I know that that is what keeps it going. There is he that scatters and yet he increases, but there is he that withholds more than is necessary, but it tends only to poverty. If you want to break the back of poverty and deliver your children and your fourth generation from poverty, be a giver, an addicted giver to the things of God and to the things to the people he commanded us to give to. As you do it generously, sincerely from your heart, God will keep increasing you. I say God will keep increasing you in the name of Jesus. There is a grace. There is he that increases because he is scattering. As you scatter your gifts, your abilities, the things God put into your hand, my God will cause you to experience increase. I say you will experience increase in the name of Jesus. Finally, Paul said, I commend you, Acts chapter 20, verse 32. I commend you to God and the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. You will keep getting your own inheritance in the name of Jesus. There is a grace for those who are sanctified. You are not to live like those who are not sanctified. My God will distinguish you. I say, my God will distinguish you. Among your peers, you will not look the same. My God, the way he separated Daniel from his peers will separate you from your peers. In the name of Jesus, I have never, in all sense of humility, I submit to you again. I have to say these things because there is nothing you can give if you don't have it. I know by the grace of God, I have never looked like my peers. Not for the last 20, 30 years. I don't look like my peers. Everywhere I am, I'm always distinguished because I realize that when you are connected to God, something is different about you. You will enjoy things that your peers do not enjoy. I say favors that your peers do not enjoy, you will enjoy. The kind of promotion that doesn't come the way of your peers will come your way. In the name of Jesus. In this kingdom, promotion is not until you become a CEO. It's not until you become a title per se. It is about enhancing your status, no matter what you are called. You may be called an assistant carer. Is there anything like that? Assistant carer? Or care assistant? That's the one. Care assistant? You may be called care assistant and be favored more than the proprietor of that organization. When favor works on your life, nobody can deny it. Nehemiah was a cupbearer. When favor shone on him, he led a nation. Joseph was a captive. When favor shone on him, he led a nation. It doesn't matter where you are today. Stop doing the rat race with them. Trying to fight. I don't fight for promotion. I don't fight for promotion. I go for promotion, but if you think you deny me a promotion, what I find is that God has already promoted me. All those things you are putting in your paper is just a waste of time. It's a waste of time. My God will distinguish you. Wherever you need to get to, whatever position you need to get to, my God will take you there. But whatever it is, wherever you are, as you give generously, my God will increase you. I say he will increase you in the name of Jesus. You will have your own inheritance among all those who are sanctified in the mighty name of Jesus. Finally, Letoniel said, by accepting God as your partner, there is no limit to what can be achieved. I want you to know that as you walk with God, not even the sky will be your limit. As you walk with God, things will happen for you. In this church, every last Sunday like this, we give a welfare offering. I noticed that we need to emphasize the importance. What we do with it is that we give to those who are in need, at times amongst us and at times around us in the community that we live. It is very important that you make sure that you give something to that. It is your opportunity of connecting yourself to a covenant of lending to the Lord. The Bible says when you give to the poor, you lend unto the Lord. Psalm 41. Please make sure, whatever it is, remember the last Sunday of the month, you want to give something. Don't use that to decrease your offering. Don't say, if my offering is supposed to be 10 pounds, okay, last Sunday, I cut it. You take a knife from your kitchen and cut it into two. You put 1 5 pounds there, put 1 5. That does not bless you anywhere. You need to just understand that you go out to be a blessing to others and God will bless you. I say God will bless you. I want to pray for you specially today, so please rise to your feet and let us look unto God.